Good afternoon. Welcome to today's webinar, Statistical Tools for Attorneys in Litigation, Part 2. In Part 1 of this three-part series, Dr. Jack Revelle provided a thorough introduction to and discussion about numerical data. In Part 2, his focus will be on the basic statistical tools, i.e., elements of probability, descriptive statistics, counting and measuring, compound events, statistical significance, random variables and their probability, frequency distributions, and statistical interference. As with Part 1, the presenter for today's program is Dr. Jack Revelle. Dr. Revelle is a consulting statistician with a PhD in industrial engineering and management. Dr. Revelle provides technical assistance in both quality and industrial engineering to attorneys involved in litigation. As he did in Part 1, Dr. Revelle will be taking questions from webinar attendees at both the midpoint of his presentation as well as the conclusion. If you have a question, please use the chat feature, which is found on the right-hand side of the screen, to submit your questions to the presenter. We encourage all attendees to submit questions throughout the presentation. Tomorrow morning, I will send out an email with a link to the archived recording of this webinar, as well as a copy of the PowerPoint presentation used during the program. We do ask that you take time to fill out the survey that will appear on your screen after today's program is over. I now invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy. I'm going to turn the presentation over to our distinguished guest, Dr. Jack Revelle. Jack, the presentation is now all yours.
Thank you very much, Matt, and hello to everybody. I'm glad to be back, and for those of you who were able to sit in on my previous presentation, the Part 1 of Statistical Tools for Attorneys in Litigation, welcome back. As Matt pointed out, we'll be talking about a variety of different topics. If you're interested in finding out a little bit more about myself as to my qualifications, the screen that is up in front right now will give you some background in terms of various things that I've been involved in and what you need to know to find more about me. If you want to check my website, it's www.revelle, spelled the way it is at the top of the screen, solutionsplural.com. And now let's go, as they say, on with the show. In the previous presentation, Part 1, we talked all about data. We talked about primarily quantitative data, data with numbers. And that's as opposed to qualitative data, data using words. And believe it or not, words can be analyzed. Today, we're going to be talking about basic statistical tools. And then in the Part 3, to be scheduled in the near future, I'll be talking about survey research methods. How attorneys can make use of the various tools of survey research in order to strengthen their case for their clients. And now, let's go on with Part 2. As Matt said, we'll start out with elements of probability, look at descriptive statistics, counting and measuring, compound events, significance, random variables, and their probability distributions, and finally, that's statistical inference. Let's begin with the elements of probability. And let's see, probability, I'm sure everybody's used the word one time or another, but in statistics, we have very specific definitions for terms, and in this case, probability is the likelihood, the chance, that a specific event will or will not occur. Probability is usually expressed mathematically as P parens X parens, that is, the probability or likelihood that a particular event, which we'll refer to as X in this case, will occur. The data that underlie the calculations used to determine the probability of X must be carefully specified and collected to ensure the accuracy of the resulting probability value. How about some examples? And these are all examples of from cases that I've worked on through TASA attorneys. First, what is the probability of occurrence of a specific type of defect? For example, an unintended pre- premature deployment of an airbag occurring in a 2011 Model X. An unintended explosion of an unused compressed gas computer keyboard duster in an automobile. An electrical shock resulting from a short circuit in a new model smartphone. Those are all probabilities. Probability of 10%, 20%, 50%, 0.005%, whatever it might be. A probability is a way of assigning every possible event that could occur a specific value between 0.00 and 1.00. To qualify as a probability, the assignment of values must satisfy the requirement that within a collection of mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive events, that is, all the possible events with no common results, the sum of the probabilities of all the individual events will be 1. For example, something as simple as flipping a coin. Two events are possible, a head or a tail. I'm leaving out the landing on the side. It's never happened to me. The probability of a head is 0.5. The probability of a tail is 0.5. The sum is 1. The two events are mutually exclusive. That is, if one happens, the other cannot happen. And they are collectively exhaustive. That is, those are the only two possible events that can take place. When those two criteria are met, mutual exclusivity and collectively exhaustive, then the sum of the probabilities of all the events will be 1. And that's not just sometimes, folks. That's all the time. The probability of an event A is written, as I said earlier, as the probability of A. The opposite or complement of an event A, that is the probability of not A, is written as P parens A, a prime number, a prime symbol, and a paren. Thus, the probability of A plus the probability of not A equals 1. If two events, A and B, occur during a single performance of an experiment, this is called the intersection or joint probability of A and B, and is denoted as P paren A, the symbol for and B paren. If two events A and B are independent, that means they have no relationship to each other, then their joint probability is the probability of A and B is equal to the probability of A and B is equal to, and this is mathematically how you would determine it, the probability of A times the probability of B. And we go back to the coin example. If two coins are flipped, the chance of both being heads is the probability of a head and a head is equal to the probability of head and head, which is equal to 1/2 times 1/2 equals 1/4. If either event A or event B, or both, occur during a single run of an experiment, this is called the union, symbolized with the letter U, of the events A and B, and is denoted as P, the probability of A union B. If two events are mutually exclusive, remember that means that if one happens, the other can't, then the probability of either occurring is the probability of A or B equals the probability of A union B, which is equal to the probability of A plus the probability of B. Here's some examples. What's the probability of a newly created medical treatment eliminating a certain disease or causing a specific side effect? What is the probability of financial fraud in a gold investment opportunity? What is the probability that a particular marketing claim has been overstated? Now, having talked about probability, let's turn our attention to the subject of descriptive statistics. Descriptive statistics quantitatively describe primary characteristics of a collection of data. Descriptive statistics are distinguished from inferential or inductive statistics in that descriptive statistics summarize a data set, that is a sample, rather than to use it to learn about the population that the data set represents and was drawn from. Generally, this means that descriptive statistics, unlike inferential statistics, which we'll talk about later on in this presentation, are not developed on the basis of probability theory. Even when data analysis draws its primary or main conclusions using inferential statistics, descriptive statistics are generally also presented to help clarify conclusions, especially in a deposition or in a courtroom situation. Here's some examples. We can use either a pie chart or a bar chart to provide a visual summary of the data set. On the left bottom of the screen, you see on the far left a pie chart. And one particular portion of the pie chart, which is in the approximately between 2 and 4 o'clock position, is especially important in this particular presentation. And so what we've done is we've pulled it out and shown what it looks like one level down. Over on the right side, we have a horizontal bar chart. And I say horizontal because bar charts, as you well know, can be either horizontal or vertical. And we see frequency of occurrence on the horizontal axis and the number of events taking place are shown with the various bars with three different series of categories. And the categories themselves, there are four of those. And these might be, series 1, 2, and 3 might be the year 2008, 2009, 2010 in four different categories, and then at the bottom showing the frequency of occurrence as reflected in the data. Pie charts, like bar charts, have been used for as long as most of us can remember. They are just two of many possible forms of graphical data displays. Usually, a tally sheet is converted into a data table, which is then converted into a pie chart or a bar chart. A pie chart helps describe various aspects of data by presenting it as segments of a pie, as we saw on the previous slide. The proportion of a pie chart segment parallels the percentage, item by item, in its corresponding data table. In the event that it's important to emphasize one or more of the major segments of a pie chart, either enlarged pie segments, as we saw earlier, or a special form of a bar chart known as a Pareto chart, could be used. Pareto was an Italian economist back in the late 1800s, early 1900s, and when he was working on his doctorate in economics, he discovered that about 80% of the wealth in Italy at that time was in the hands of 20% of the people. And that is now referred to as the Pareto rule, the 80-20 rule, that 80% of your problems come from 20% of your problem sources, as an example. And here's a Pareto chart. What we've got is a number of different kinds of defects or non-conforming items on the horizontal axis and the frequency of occurrence on the vertical axis. So we see that category A, the numbers reversed, has occurred 104 times in the 31 days that the data was collected. Now, how did I know about 31 days? Up at the top it says from day 1 to day 31. Apparently that's one particular month. And if you sum up all the different defects that we have and divide the 104 into that total, which happens to be in this case something over 200, then what we have is 52%. And we do that for each of the columns as we move from left to right. And so what we have there is that series of points connected by the straight lines is a cumulative curve to show 52% if you're looking at just category A, 73%, nearly three quarters if you include columns A and B, that's numbers reversed and numbers omitted. And the same way as we move from left to right. You'll notice there's a column over on the far right called Others. Those are the onesie-twosie kinds of things. Rather than throw the data away, which we may have to analyze later, we just summarize it or collect it and give it into that very last column, and it occurred 18 times. Now, that, if those are all 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know it's going to be 5 or less. Otherwise, it would show up in one of the other columns. Then you know that what we've got there could be another 5 to 6, 7 columns. But that's a Pareto diagram. Now, continuing our discussion of descriptive statistics, a bar chart is a form of graphical a bar chart is a form of graphical presentation designed to quickly and simply communicate quantitative information. It can be displayed with the bars oriented either vertically or horizontally, depending on the inclination and the needs of the attorney to prove a point. A bar chart always has two dimensions, the horizontal or x-axis, which is traditionally used for an independent variable, that's something that you have no control over, and the vertical axis or y-axis, which is used to describe the dependent variable. In case you're not coming very quickly on the, what I mean by independent versus dependent variable, if we had a graph of the heights versus the weights of people, we have no control over our heights. We do have control over our weights. And so what we do is we put heights, let's say from arbitrarily starting at 5 foot and ending at, say, 6 foot 6, going across from left to right on the horizontal axis, and then weights that might start at, say, 90 pounds at the bottom of the left-hand axis and going up to, I'll make up a number, 250 pounds. And then we would plot a variety of points. And we'll be talking about what we call scatter diagrams later on in the presentation, and we'll see that we have always the independent variable on the bottom or horizontal axis and the dependent variable on the vertical or y-axis. And we continue to do it that way only because it's tradition, but people from the time they start learning about graphs and numbers have been exposed to this, and if we reverse it, it's going to make understanding a little more complicated. And that's the last thing we want to do in a courtroom presentation. The independent variable can be either variable or continuous data, or attribute or discrete data. A histogram is a bar chart which presents variable or continuous data as the independent variable. As we saw earlier, a Pareto diagram is a bar chart using attribute or discrete data as the independent variable. Both histograms and Pareto diagrams use the vertical axis to communicate about the dependent variable, which is usually the frequency of occurrence. It can also be cost or duration. I wanted you to be able to at least hear about, without a lot of discussion, about some common probability or frequency models. The normal distribution, that's your traditional bell-shaped curve. The binomial distribution, the hypergeometric distribution, the Poisson distribution, the exponential distribution, and the student's T distribution. And it is worthwhile noting that each distribution, not just these, but all distributions, has their own unique average or mean, as well as the standard deviation, which you may recall from my first presentation, is a measure of variation or variability around the average or mean, as well as other statistical parameters, and these are known as moments. There's a third moment, fourth moment, etc. Now let's turn our attention to counting and measuring. Numerical data can be collected in two ways, either by counting. This approach is used when attribute or discrete data is involved. An example, an inventory count in a warehouse at a defined period of time. It can also be collected by measuring. This approach is used when variable or continuous data is involved. An example, how long it takes to complete one or more tasks. Counting and measuring. This is where we decide what data to collect and when to do it. We want to know what's really important. We decide how to collect the data. Are we going to count it? We'll do that for attribute data. Or are we going to measure it? We do this for variable data. Some additional examples of counting. How many days will a case last? How many jurors will likely be excused for cause? For how many years will a convicted felon be incarcerated? How many witnesses will be introduced to the court? Here's some examples of measuring. What are the coordinates? GPS coordinates is an example of a specific location. How tall is a particular building? How much does a specific package of drugs weigh? How long did a particular phone call last? Now, it's time to talk about compound events. A compound event is one that is expressed in terms of other events. For example, given two events A and B, a compound event or statement could be both events A and B occur together, or either event A or event B occur, or neither A nor B occur. Let's examine or interpret a Venn diagram. You'll see one in just a minute. A Venn diagram is a graphic representation of certain events and their sample spaces. For two events, event A and event B, the sample space can be represented either by S, we use that for the sample space, or by U, the universe of all possible outcomes. Now let's consider a Venn diagram of two events, A and B, in which the two circular regions that we're going to see indicate the presence and relationship of the events. There's the Venn diagram at the bottom of the screen. These two events are mutually exclusive, as I said before, if they cannot occur at the same time. That is, they have no outcomes in common. As you can see, the two events in this Venn diagram do not overlap. These are called mutually exclusive events, like a head or a tail. Or in the case of rolling a die, a single dot, a double dot, a triple dot, etc. Note that in this Venn diagram on slide 32, note that the two events overlap. These are not referred to as mutually exclusive events because clearly there is a time when both event A and event B may occur, and we very easily calculate the probability. Some examples of compound events. A person is shot and stabbed. A vehicle runs out of fuel and has a flat tire. A cell phone loses connectivity to the web and the battery dies. A train stops in its tracks and is hit by a second train. I was in China last year in July working on the design of the second generation bullet train when the first generation had an accident, a major accident where hundreds of people were hurt and quite a few were killed when one bullet train hit another. A deceased person's will hasn't been properly witnessed or dated. These are examples of compound events. Now, before I go on to begin to discuss significance, let's take a break and see if there are any questions that any of you have with regard to the presentation so far. Matt, you want to
check it out? Thank you, Jack. I was about to jump in and see if the group had any questions. And we do have a question here from RJ who asked, can you talk about what bases or bases you find your expert testimony most frequently attacked by opposing counsel, or if not you, other statisticians? How do opposing counsel try to question what statisticians do in their work with litigators?
I've never had that happen, and I've never heard of it being happened. Almost every time I get involved in a really big case, the opposing side, whether the plaintiff or the defense, will have their own statistician. And it's a matter of discussion. It's not a matter of defending the practice of statistics or what the work that, that statisticians do, but rather the concern is the approach that you use. Are you using the right formula? Are you analyzing all the data? Are you considering the various factors that underlie the collection of the data and how it was analyzed? So I have never had a situation where either my profession or myself personally has been challenged. Rather, they just want clarity, and that's why I like to use graphical descriptions as opposed to presenting formulas and having to work those out in either in a deposition or a court situation.
Excellent. Thank you, Jack. And to follow up on that question, at what point during a case should an attorney seek to engage the services of a statistician? Is there a point at which the statistician is most valuable during discovery, during, you know, what stage of the case should an attorney bring in a statistician?
As early as possible. I just finished with a case right now that I'm going to be deposed on sometime in the next few weeks, where there was some data that was presented during discovery, and the statistician, the need for a statistician was apparently obvious to the requesting attorney, and he provided me with all the data after he contracted with me through TASA, and I analyzed the data and gave him my preliminary analysis, and he asked me to complete the analysis and then prepare a declaration, which we did, and which has been submitted now in a summary judgment activity where the defendant had requested a summary judgment. And what we're trying to do through the use of my data analysis is to make the point that the plaintiff really has a case, and so as to dismiss the summary judgment.
Okay, excellent. Of the topics that you've covered already during the program, which do you use more often, or most often, and which are you asked to which of these tools do you use most often, and which one do you find the most difficult to explain?
Wow, that's a two-parter. I don't find that any particular tool shows up most frequently, let me use an old saying that we've got in the statistics profession, and that is, when the only tool that you've got is a hammer, all your problems start looking like nails. What I try to do, and I think all good practicing applied statisticians do, and that is to take a look at the situation, listen very carefully to what the attorney has to say, and make sure we understand what the challenge is so that we select the best tool. And because every case is different, every tool is different. Sometimes I'll use probabilities. Sometimes I'll use a Venn diagram. Sometimes I'll use descriptive statistics. There's no way of saying one tool is the most popular. That's like saying which sport is the most popular. It depends who you ask and what their experience is and what their likes and dislikes are. Tell me again the second question.
The second part of the question was what concept of the concept that you've already discussed do you find most difficult for those who don't have a background in statistics to grasp?
The problem is usually the preliminary definitions. Like when I made my initial presentation for TASA on statistics for attorneys in litigation, first thing I did is start providing underlying definitions. It would be like my saying, talking about a house without defining what a house is in very simple terms that everybody could understand. And so if there's going to be a complicated explanation, I begin with a description of the various terms that I'm going to use, and will frequently put them on a board so that the members of the jury, the opposing counsel, and the judge can see these terms in definition while I'm talking about some particular analysis that I've done using these terms on a regular basis. So if I use a particular term X, their eyes turn to the board and say, okay, I remember, I know what he's talking about now. So I think it's the responsibility of the attorney that employs the consulting statistician, a person like myself, or the statistician, or the two working together, to choose a media methodology so as to make it as easy as possible for, as I say, opposing counsel, the jury, and the court to understand the terms that are being used.
Okay, great. Jack, we've had some people say that you sound a little distant or are fading a little bit. So if you could just try to speak up a tad, we'll continue on with the presentation of content.
I'm going to use a double tad. Ready for me to go ahead?
Yep, you're good to go.
Okay. Now we're on slide 34, beginning our discussion of significance. In statistics, a result is referred to as being significant if it is unlikely to have occurred by chance. As used in statistics, significant does not mean important or meaningful, as it does in everyday speech. Statistical software packages generally report statistical significance using a test statistic and a p-value, p for probability, ranging from anywhere from 0 to 1. If the p-value is less than some pre-selected critical value, that is the critical alpha is a percentage or probability, then the p is considered to be statistically significant. Data analysts who focus solely on statistically significant results may miss important response patterns, which individually can fall under the threshold set for test of statistical significance. Now, I recognize that without having some graphics here in front of us, that's kind of difficult to capture the thought if you've never seen it before. But we have to keep this down to 50 minutes, so I'll go on. Many researchers urge that tests of significance should always be accompanied by effect size statistics, which approximate the size and thus the practical importance of the difference. In statistics, an effect size is a measure of the strength of the relationship between two variables in a statistical population or a sample-based estimate of that quantity. In that way, effect sizes complement inferential statistics, such as p-values. Among other uses, effect size measures play an important role in studies that summarize findings from a specific area of research and in statistical power analyses. The concept of effect size appears already in everyday language. For example, a weight loss program may boast that it leads to an average weight loss of 30 pounds. And we see those on TV all the time. In this case, 30 pounds is an indicator of the claimed effect size. Another example is that a tutoring program may claim that it raises school performance by one letter grade. This grade increases the claimed effect size of the program. These are both examples of absolute effect sizes. This means that they convey the average difference between two groups without any discussion of the variability within the groups. For example, if the weight loss program results in an average loss of 30 pounds, it is possible that every participant lost exactly 30 pounds, unlikely but possible, or more likely that half the participants lost 60 pounds and the other half lost no weight at all. Reporting effect sizes is considered good practice when presenting the results of empirical research in depositions or in court testimony. The reporting of effect sizes assists in understanding the magnitude as opposed to the statistical significance of a research result. Effect sizes are particularly prominent in social and medical research. And there's also a thing we need to know about, and that's relative versus absolute measures of effect size, which convey different information and can effectively be used to complement one another. A prominent task force within the psychology research community has expressed the following recommendation. The amount of evidence required to accept that an event is unlikely to have arisen by chance is known as the significance level or critical p-value. In traditional statistical hypothesis testing, the p-value is the probability of observing data at least as great as that which was observed, given that the null hypothesis is true. It's the first time I've talked about hypotheses. The null hypothesis is the hypothesis that there is no difference. For example, let's say the scores of grades in one school versus the grades in another school. The null hypothesis would be that there is no difference. The alternate hypothesis would be that there is a difference. And what we would do is take the data and analyze it, and using the statistical hypothesis testing p-value, determine whether or not there was a statistically significant difference. If the obtained p-value is small, then it can be said that either the null hypothesis is false or an unusual event has occurred. An alternate statistical hypothesis testing approach requires that both a null and an alternate hypothesis be defined and tested. This approach requires examination of the repeat sampling properties and can result in either of two types of errors. The probability that a decision to reject the null hypothesis will be made when it is actually true and should not have been rejected. This is referred to as a false positive or type 1 error. The probability that a decision will be made to accept the null hypothesis when it's actually false is known as a type 2 error. Using effect sizes in lieu of p-values to explain significance in court is highly recommended, since they are much easier to understand and don't require that judges, juries, and other attorneys have any knowledge of applied statistics. Now let's turn our attention to random variables and their probability distributions. In probability and statistics, a stochastic or random variable is one whose value results from an assessment of some type of random process. A random variable is a numerical description of a process outcome. For example, the possible results of flipping a coin. It may be a head or a tail. Rolling two dice, it might be one dot and another dot. And on the second, one dot and two dots, etc. Or even the winning numbers on a lottery. Intuitively, a random variable can be thought of as a quantity whose value is not fixed, but which can take on a range of different values between some fixed limits. A probability distribution is used to describe the probability of occurrence of different values. For example, a normal distribution composed of continuous data, or a Poisson distribution, which is made up of discrete data. There are two types of random variables. Random variables can be classified either as discrete or continuous. When they're discrete, it's a random variable that can assume a finite, that is, limited quantity of a whole number of values, having no fractions or decimals. For example, n, which is the identification of sample numbers, can run from 1 to 5, or an infinite sequence of values, for example, from 1 to infinity. That sideways 8 is the symbol that's used in mathematics and statistics for infinity. It's very similar to the automobile symbol for the infinity, although they've kind of modernized it. And another way random variables can be classified as continuous. This is a random variable that can assume any numerical value in an interval or collection of intervals. For example, 1/2, 0.501, 5'11¾", etc. A discrete random variable maps outcomes to values of a countable set. For example, the integers, with each value in the range having a probability greater than or equal to 0. A continuous random variable maps outcomes to values of an uncountable set, for example, the real numbers. For a continuous random variable, the probability of any specific value is 0, whereas the probability of some infinite set of values, such as an interval of non-zero length, may be positive. A random variable can be mixed, with part of its probability spread over an interval like a typical continuous variable, and part of it concentrated on particular values like a discrete variable. These classifications are equivalent to the categorization of probability distributions. Now here's a probability distribution. Looks like a normal distribution, but it's not. On the horizontal or x-axis, we have the sum of two dice which are being rolled. And for example, at the far left, the two dice each have a 1, and so the sum is 2. At the far right, we have two boxcars, and they sum up to 12. In the center, where the sum of two dice is 7, obviously one is a 4 and the other is 3, or 5 and 2, or 2 and 5, or 1 and 6, or 6 and 1, etc. And the probabilities of those occurring, each of those sums, is listed on the far left. And this is a situation where we're dealing with finite and discrete data. Here's the traditional normal distribution that we always hear about. You can see the mean, which has like the letter mu, it looks like the letter U, in the center. That's the average or mean. Then we have on either side of the mean the standard deviations. Remember, the standard deviation is a measure of variability around the average or mean. And we can go off to the right to plus 1 standard deviation, plus 2, or plus 3. And off to the left, minus 1 standard deviation, minus 2 standard deviations, minus 3 standard deviations. Now, graphically, one of the easiest ways to determine where standard deviation is, although it's more likely that you're going to calculate it, is where the curve, as you depart the mean at the center, at the peak of the distribution, you notice that the curve is curving outward, and then all of a sudden, or should I say gradually, it starts curving inward. At that point of inflection, that's where the standard deviation is. That's one standard deviation. And so if you go plus or minus one standard deviation around the mean, you have a total of 68.2% of the data, just over two-thirds of the data. And if you go out two more standard deviations on either side of the mean, you've got plus two standard deviations to minus two standard deviations. That represents about 95% of all the data under the curve. And if you go out to plus or minus three standard deviations, you're talking about 99.73%, and traditionally we treat that as virtually 100% of all the data under the standard normal distribution. And here's a Poisson distribution. And in this case, you see that as we move with a mean from left to right, from a very low mean to a very high mean, lambda in this case is the symbol that we use for the mean. When lambda is 1, that's the orange circle, you see that we have a rather strange-looking distribution. When lambda moves up to 4, we have a kind of a skewed distribution with the purple dots. And when you get to the kind of pale blue dots, we've got the mean centered on lambda equals 10, and you notice it looks just like a bell-shaped curve, and if you take a look at the note, it says when the mean lambda is greater than or equal to 10, the normal distribution that we just looked at in the previous slide is used to approximate the Poisson distribution. This is commonly done in statistics. It's a lot easier to do calculations on the normal distribution, and use that to approximate the Poisson, but you can't do it legally, or you shouldn't do it, unless the mean of the Poisson distribution that you're working with is 10 or greater. The probabilities are for each of the various means, and the points on the curve are listed over on the far left on the vertical axis. Now let's talk about statistical inference. In statistics, statistical inference is the process of drawing conclusions from data that are subject to random variation, for example, either observational errors or sampling variation. The terms statistical inference, statistical induction, and inferential statistics are all used to describe sets of procedures that are used for drawing conclusions from data sets which arise from those systems that are affected by random variation. Initial requirements of a set of procedures for inference and induction are that they should produce reasonable answers when applied to well-defined situations, and that they should be general enough to be applied across a range of situations. The outcome of statistical inference may be an answer to the question, what should be done next? Where this might be a decision about conducting further experiments or surveys, or about drawing a conclusion before implementing some organizational or government policy. Some examples. Given the past 3 years of data, what should we expect to happen this coming year or the year after that? That might be performance evaluations as an example, or the number of defects that you're experiencing in a particular line of product. Based on the most recent past, should we expect to see more of the same? Would including more past data in our analysis increase the accuracy of our forecasts? Now, here's that scatter diagram I was talking about. The horizontal axis is average house sizes in square feet. The vertical axis is cycle time in days to complete construction for each of the different models. The letters A through I are various home designs. We go ahead and plot those, and we're able to develop upper and lower limits that we expect the data to fall in, except for one that falls outside the upper limit, which is the letter E. Now, in this way, we can use it to identify relationships between variables, in this case, the variables being different home designs. But I use this particular tool extensively. I think back to the earlier question about, is there any tools in particular that I use most frequently? I won't say that I use this one frequently, but I do use it a great deal to help explain differences. When you present it graphically like this, you can see a lot of different things. For example, you can see that the group of houses A, G, and H all have a very low cycle time. But you see that when you get into larger ones like B, J, and D, they have much larger cycle times. But that's for further discussion at a later time. Let's bring this presentation to a conclusion. By now, it should be apparent that attorneys need to have at least a superficial knowledge of statistical tools. There's no need for attorneys to become statistical experts, but they should be able to recognize when statistics and applied statisticians are needed to make their strongest case. All you need to win your case is to arrange to collect current, relevant data and know the best way to analyze and present it in court. Then, my friends, you're on your way. And with that, I will turn it back to Matt, who will lead any questions that you may have. Matt?
Okay, excellent. Thank you, Jack. We do have a couple questions in the queue, and I would encourage all the attendees to submit their questions to Jack, and we'll try to answer them in the next 12 minutes or so. Jack, you concluded by talking about data. We have a question here from Dan who asks, can you give some examples of how one may assess the quality of data that's being used or offered up?
Okay, now I'm going to play, I don't mean to play a game, but it's going to sound like that. I'll do a Bill Clinton. Can you tell me what you mean by the quality of the data? I'll ask you to ask Dan.
I'll take clarification, but I think we're talking about accuracy of the data or pertinent of the data.
Well, those are two different things, accuracy and the pertinence. One of the most important things is currency. You know, if you've got data from 5 years ago, I would say that's not current data. Current data is data that has occurred as recently as possible because processes change, situations change, and data that that was generated prior to many of these changes is not going to be valid in the analysis to help understand how something occurred. Its relevance, if for example, I mentioned earlier about collecting data, comparing grades in two different schools. Suppose you were to compare the grades in grade 6 in one school and grade 12 in another school. Not relevant. You want to do a comparison that is a fair comparison in terms of, so you're comparing apples and apples and not apples and oranges. So quality of data, if I understand correctly from what you said, is the ability to use this data to present a valid argument in favor of the case that is being made by the attorney that's using the data. Does that make sense?
Okay, thank you. And to follow up on that question, are there some best practices that can be employed by either attorneys or experts to ensure the best data is not the term I want to use, but that the most relevant data is collected?
Start that question again, Matt.
Sure. Are there best practices out there for attorneys to follow or for other experts to follow to ensure the sanctity of the data?
Yes, I think there is. There's nothing that's ever been written down, but it's just, I think, good common sense. The statistician and attorney in consultation and discussion will find out, its relevance, it's how recent it is, the assessment of the accuracy of the data. If the statistician needs data to the third decimal place and all you've got is to the first decimal place, clearly that's not going to work. So it's a matter of discussions, and a checklist could be developed, but I've never seen one because each particular case stands on its own, and so it's important that the attorney who's decided that he or she is going to be using a statistician to help make their case, that they have long discussions with that statistician to make sure that what they are either have collected or will collect is what the statistician needs in order to provide the kind of response that the attorney is hoping for.
Okay, great. I think this question goes back to the first presentation, but I think it'll be good to touch on again. Can you go over just very briefly how to determine the population size for a survey of a random sampling of people?
Oh, the size of the sample, how much to draw from the population?
Yes.
Okay, now there's a series of four formulas that I presented during that first presentation. And you have to know whether you're dealing with continuous or discrete data, what kind of confidence level you want to work with. And you plug in some of these numbers into these very simple, straightforward equations, and that will tell you what the sample size is. For example, let's suppose that you have a population, I'll make up a number, of 500 people. The sample size you need could vary from 10 to 500 to 100, depending on the parameters that you're using. For example, do you want to be 95% confident, 90% confident, 80% confident? What level of accuracy do you want? Does it have to be plus or minus 1 or plus or minus 0.01, plus or minus 5? So you plug these various factors in, and there's only two or three factors that you plug in, and you grind out very quickly what the sample size is. If I had the equations in front of me, what I would do is just ask the attorney, what do you want for your confidence level? What kind of accuracy do you expect, et cetera? And it would be almost immediately able to give them back a number. But more importantly than the number of the sample size is the cost of the sampling, because obviously each sample calls for an expenditure of funds. And there may be a budget for only so many dollars. And so it becomes a trade-off between how much you're going to spend on the survey or the sample in order to get as close as to what you're looking for within your budget.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jack. We have a question here that goes back, I think, to the first question of the day, but it's a little different than that first question. Under what circumstances would statistical evidence not be admissible?
Got a very narrow-minded judge.
Did you find that most of the statistical work that you do on cases is admitted without any questions?
Yeah, if the statistician that you're using has good qualifications and are recognized by the court as being someone who's had experience dealing with numbers and dealing with the court, the question isn't so much about the statistics as it is about the statistician. If you're taking somebody who's just graduated with his master's or doctorate, and this is the first case they've ever pleaded, the judge might look at that more narrowly than if you've got somebody who's been around for 10, 20, 30 years and has assisted in a variety of cases on both sides of the aisle.
Okay, great. We have a question here from JC, and this is a general question, but maybe you could give kind of a range. JC asks, what type of cases have you worked on? Like, what type of cases do you find merit bringing in a statistician? And I'm sure there's a whole wide range of cases, but if you could just give a couple examples here really quickly of what types of cases you work on and how statistics apply to those cases.
Well, let's see. Sometimes I work on cases that don't involve just statistics. It may involve the practice of implementing quality. Several of the examples I gave in this presentation were actual cases that I worked on. For example, we had that gas duster that I mentioned that exploded in a car and put a guy's eye out. He was just carrying the duster from his office to a place where he was going to use it as a part of his job of cleaning electronic equipment, like computers. And I've also done some work for the Attorney General of California. And in that case, they had data that was generated by an offshore company that was bringing product into the United States. And the Franchise Tax Board, which is the California equivalent of the Internal Revenue Service, had charged them a particular level of taxes. And this company that was producing the product that was being imported to the United States claimed that they were being overtaxed, and they provided data. And in deposition, I was in support of the Franchise Tax Board, and the offshore company, had a statistician that was an academic, a very good academic, and very, very strong statistical credentials, and he made some statements that were just, from my perspective as a statistician, dead wrong. And in the deposition, I pointed out the errors that he made, and then pointed out that the data that was presented by this company was conflicted within itself. And one set of data said one thing, and if you look at it very carefully, another table of their data said just the opposite. And I said, you can't have it both ways. You know, you either did this or you did that, but you can't do both. It was not a compound event. It was a single event. And see, then I remember a case where a product was being produced by several different levels of manufacturers. One produced an item, the other filled the item, and a third one stored and transported the item, and we were trying to find out where the defect occurred and why it occurred, so that it could be proven that the people that manufactured or filled the product were negligent. And so, wherever there's a quality problem, wherever there's a statistical problem, a layout problem, because as an undergraduate in chemical engineering and a master's and doctorate in industrial engineering, I'm able to take on a range of cases that can vary so much that it's difficult to say, here's one case, I always do this kind of case kind of thing. Probably the best thing to do is is for the attorney to make a request to TASA for someone who is knowledgeable about X or Y or Z, and the folks at TASA have a complete knowledge of every subject matter expert's background, and they will do their very best to put the attorney in contact with the expert who has the type of knowledge that's necessary to achieve the goals that the attorney is interested in achieving.
Very good. I don't see any more questions in the queue, so why don't we wrap up today's presentation. Jack, do you have any concluding remarks that you would like to make?
Just one. The third presentation in this sequence is going to be about survey research methods, and I'm going to talk more about sample size, data collection, how to choose the subjects for the sample, and we'll spend an entire period, an entire hour talking about what to do, how to collect data that's never been collected before, how to choose your subjects, and you end up with the data that can be used in court or in deposition that will never have the ability to be challenged.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jack, and thank you for the time that you spent putting this presentation together. Thank you for all the attendees who took time out of your schedule to join us for an hour today. I'm going to wrap things up here very quickly. If you have a case that you would like to speak to Dr. Revelle about, you can contact us here at TASA. Our telephone number is 800-523-2319. As I mentioned during the introduction, we will be sending out the link to the archive recording of this webinar tomorrow morning. The archive recording of this webinar, along with all of our other programs, can be found on TASA's website. Just visit www.tasanet.com and click on the Knowledge Center tab, which is found at the top of the screen. Our next webinar for legal professionals, Airports and Compatible Land Use Planning, will take place on May 22nd. You will receive an email from me in the next week or so inviting you to that program. And if you have any questions or comments for us, we do take all of your comments under consideration. They help us to produce better programs. Please send me an email. My email address is mhide@tasanet.com. You'll be receiving an email at approximately 3:30 p.m. thanking you for attending. You can just reply to that email. On behalf of all of the staff at TASA and Dr. Revelle, I want to thank you for your time, and I look forward to seeing you at future TASA events. I'm going to end today's program.